Hello, this is Lazarus at Telecom Tech, where telecom and networking technologies are simply explained. Today, we'll be simply explaining the OSPF Neighbor Discovery Process. Before we get into that, let me tell you very quickly. You can check out my website at telecomtech.io, where you can find detailed blog posts on topics covered on the YouTube channel. And you can register for my newsletter, where you'll get information of new content. I promise I won't spam you. And coming very soon on the site, in-depth courses and labs, configurations, quizzes, practice exams, and downloadable content in PDF format. Now that that's out of the way, let's continue talking about OSPF. Now, like most dynamic routing protocols, OSPF relies on the establishment of neighbor adjacencies between OSPF routers. In the previous video, we saw the prerequisites for the establishment of OSPF neighbors, at least from a configuration point of view. Let's review once again the required configuration in order to establish an OSPF adjacency. First of all, we have to enable the OSPF process. We have to define which networks are participating in the routing protocol, and interfaces with addresses found within the range of the network command here are enabled with OSPF, and they begin sending out multicast packets searching for an OSPF neighbor. So by implementing these configurations, the Gigabit Ethernet 01 interface on R1 begins to search for an OSPF neighbor on that link. If R2 is configured accordingly, the neighbor discovery process begins. Now, before we talk about the discovery process itself, we need to first define certain parameters. Now, an important part of the operation of OSPF is the router ID. It is typically manually configured in the OSPF routing configuration. If it's not explicitly configured, an OSPF router will choose the highest IP address on a loopback interface. If there is no configured loopback interface on the device, it will use the highest IP address on an active interface. Now, the router ID serves only as an identifier for the router within the OSPF domain. This identifier must be unique, otherwise there will be an error in the neighbor adjacency process. Now, OSPF uses a series of messages between OSPF routers to establish adjacencies. The first is what is known as hello packets. These are used for neighbor discovery, as well as adjacency maintenance. They contain the local router ID of the router sending out the hello message, but they also contain much more information that is used in various other OSPF processes that we'll talk about in future videos. Next, we have the database description messages, or DBDs. These are used to initially synchronize the link state databases of the two routers. DBDs contain a summary of the local LSDB. And finally, for the purpose of understanding the neighbor discovery process, we have the link state requests, link state updates, and link state acknowledgement messages. These are messages used to exchange the link states, or essentially the networks, known by each OSPF router. With the exchange of such messages, the result is the convergence of OSPF, meaning that OSPF neighbors obtain a full and complete map of the OSPF topology. Now, having all of this information under our belt, let's go on and take a look at the OSPF neighbor adjacency process. Now, the neighbor adjacency process has several stages that it goes through. These are called neighbor states. Specifically, we start off with the down state. Now, in this state, although the interface has been enabled with OSPF, it has not yet found any active OSPF neighbors at this time. Next, we have the init state. This is the first state that an OSPF router enters when the first hello packet is received from a potential neighbor. Next, we have the two-way state. Now, this state is entered when a router sees its own router ID in the received hello packet. This indicates that the neighbor has also received our hello packet with that information, and it has sent back a hello with our own router ID. Next, we have the ExStart state, and this is entered when the master and slave roles are determined. Now, these roles must be determined between the two neighbors to define the way which the neighbors will communicate. Specifically, it defines which router will be the first to exchange information. Next, we enter the exchange state. In this state, the database description packets, or DBDs, are exchanged. This is where the actual networks begin to be advertised between neighbors. Now, in the loading state, which is the next state, we have a series of link state requests and link state update messages, or LSRs and LSUs, that are exchanged to bring the neighbor adjacency into convergence. And finally, we have the full state, which is the state when the routers have established their full adjacency. From here on in, any changes to the LSDB are simply advertised using further exchanges of LSAs between OSPF routers. Now, if at any point along this exchange, certain prerequisites are not met, the adjacency will not form. Now, I will list some of the most important prerequisites for the establishment of OSPF adjacencies. Now, these may not all be clear at this point, but I mention them here for completeness. We will, however, cover any topic that you may not yet know about at this point. So, first of all, in order for an adjacency to take place, there must be a unique router ID, as mentioned before. If two routers with the same router ID try to become neighbors, the adjacency will fail. Then the interfaces of both routers must also be in the same OSPF area. If they're in different areas, the adjacency will fail. The IP addresses of the connecting interfaces must be on the same subnet. If this is not the case, the adjacency will fail. OSPF routers use certain timers to establish adjacencies. These are the hello and dead intervals, and they are configurable. If they are not the same on both neighbors, the adjacency will fail. OSPF can also be configured to authenticate OSPF neighbors, enabling a more secure topology. If authentication settings do not match between the neighbors, the adjacency will fail. And you can also configure OSPF for various network types that may not support multicast. The configured network types on each OSPF router must be compatible with each other. Otherwise, and you guessed it, I'm sure, the adjacency will fail. Now, many of these parameters have default values, which if left unchanged, will simply work because they are the same on both ends. If, however, you change those, adjacency failure can occur. Now let's briefly look at the OSPF adjacency process in action. We'll be looking at it from the point of view of R1 and the state that R1 perceives in the process. Now in the down state, our R1 router has yet to receive a hello packet, but the OSPF process is active and is listening. And in this state, it will periodically send out hello packets. These hello packets are multicast and have a multicast destination address of 224.0.0.5. Next, in the init state, our R1 router has received a multicast hello packet from a potential neighbor on the network segment. R1 learns about R2's router ID and it puts that router ID within the OSPF neighbor table. But remember, R1 has also sent out hello packets and R2 receives those and processes those itself. Now, what happens next is that R2 will send another hello packet to R1 because it has already learned about R1 via its first hello. It sends another hello, this time as a unicast message to R1's gigabit Ethernet 01 interface IP address. This hello packet now contains information about its own router ID. So R1 has now confirmed that the potential neighbor knows about it and it has acknowledged its router ID. Now at this point on a multi-access network like Ethernet, we have our designated router and backup router elections. That is our DRBDR elections. Now, I won't go into this now. We'll see that in another video. But this must take place successfully here before moving on to the next state. Now, assuming that our DRBDR elections take place successfully, we then get to our ExStart state. This is where the neighbors determine the master-slave roles in the adjacency. The role of the master is to be the first router that will begin the exchange of DBD messages. The master is the router with the higher router ID. Now, in our topology here, since we haven't manually configured our router IDs. The loopback addresses are used as the router ID in both routers. And since 20.20.20.1 is a higher number than 10.10.10.1, R2 becomes the master. So R2 begins sending their DBD messages, which means that we have entered the exchange state. This is where the routers exchange their DBDs. Now, these DBDs essentially contain a summary of the LSDB of each router. And with the exchange of these DBDs, each router finds out about the networks they don't yet know about. And this, of course, leads to the next state, which is the loading state. Now here, each router, knowing what routes it is missing, requests the routes using LSRs. Each router responds with LSUs. And finally, once the intended information is successfully received, they are acknowledged using LSACKs. Finally, once the initial exchange of LSRs, LSUs, and LSACKs have completed, OSPF networks have converged between the routers, and the routers are said to be in the full state. This is the state in which the adjacency is complete. Now, from here on in, any changes that are detected by OSPF are exchanged using LSUs and are acknowledged by LSACKs. LSUs can result either as a response to an LSA, or they can be sent proactively when a change to a network takes place within an OSPF router, such as the configuration of the network command in R1, like so. So that is a fundamental description of the adjacency process for OSPF. I hope you found this video useful, and if you have, please click that thumbs up button. Please check out my website and subscribe to my newsletter as well. You'll find the links in the description below. And don't forget to subscribe to the channel to get updates to newly published videos. I'm Lazarus at Telecom Tech. I hope this video has been helpful for you, and I'd like to thank you for watching.